Looks like another one, Captain. Got one, 121 on his head. It's just like that case from 10 years ago. Yeah, that Walter Sullivan case.
I'm always watching you. I'm always watching you. I'm always watching you. I'm always watching you. I'm always watching you.
Silent Hill 4, The Room, is a game that can delight just as much as it can frustrate. If you've been hanging around my channel for any period of time, though, you probably know that I love Silent Hill 4. Just like the other early games in the series, Silent Hill 4, a 2004 survival horror game that was also the last Silent Hill game developed by an ever-changing team within Konami known as Team Silent, offers a remarkably haunting, disturbed experience. It uses the bones of traditional survival horror, but the flesh around those bones has warped and distorted. Sometimes the shapes it produces are new and refreshing, its narrative and spatial conceit is fantastic, whereas at other times the attempted revitalization of the gameplay can prove to be a bit frustrating, and in my opinion overly combat heavy. But it is still one of my favorite games ever made. Acknowledging the game's flaws is not apologizing for them. It is recognizing that the game would not be one of my favorites without the pain, without the frustration, without the imperfections. I like those things. My favorite games provoke healthy amounts of these feelings, that these games were made by human beings, and Silent Hill 4, The Room, very much achieves this. The game tells the story of Henry Townsend, a character with what seems like a flat pancake substituted in for his personality. Henry is trapped in room 302 in South Ashfield Heights, an apartment building in the bustling town of South Ashfield. The door is chained from the inside, and his cries for help seem to be absorbed by the very walls themselves. The game's mystery, what exactly happened in room 302, and who is causing grisly murders within Henry's quote-unquote dreams, drives the player onwards through a fairly miserable experience. The game's story is incredibly satisfying and consistently interesting, and it remains very, very replayable. This is, in part, due to the characters that are present within the narrative, but also the spaces and the themes that the game presents. You may wonder, as this video progresses, or even right now, why I do what I do, why I analyze the very structure of survival horror, and that's a fair question. My channel title might be Horror Game Analysis, but you might still want to know what the point of it all is. To preempt this question, as with my other videos, I want to say that, just like other mediums, it is important to understand how the story is told and how the experience unfolds rhythmically. Why did the developers choose to use survival horror? Even if it was a decision entirely rooted in moving copies to earn money, it is still worth examining how the genre transforms the mood of the game and the story itself. Silent Hill uses the conceit of survival horror to set up stories that reflect particular moods. Survival horror, just like different genres of poetry, can be used to different effect. This is not to say that certain genres can only be used to tell certain kinds of stories. Art is often about circumventing the limitations of the medium or the genre. In fact, we could say that Silent Hill as a series often pushes up against these limitations, as with many other survival horror titles. Subverting the genre and pushing against the boundaries, trying to redefine those boundaries, is very important. I've seen arguments online that games are low culture, that we can divide art into more or less valuable forms is ridiculous, of course, but the idea still persists, that certain forms of art are more worth examining than others. I contest that all forms of art are worth examining. Silent Hill 4 uses the boundaries of the survival horror genre and reframes them. Survival horror is often based around running around, solving puzzles, and checking doors, as well as returning to safe/save rooms. Silent Hill 4 is invested in this gameplay loop, but it also makes it more personal. It roots the player in the apartment and also in the game's antagonists. It takes the conceit of Silent Hill that it externalizes and monsterizes the underlying psychoses of some individual in the town and creates something abject from those psychoses and uses it to create a character study on a malicious serial killer, the antagonist of the game. This is, I hope you agree, a fascinating way to use space and narrative in video games. The antagonist, in actuality, becomes the protagonist. Or at least, he replaces the protagonist in terms of association and narrative importance. We understand the killer, on some level, more than we do Henry. The video will progress through every locale in the game, examining their functionality, pointing out interesting things, and showcasing how the narrative functions alongside the gameplay. It will be a study rooted in space, in hauntings and hauntology, monster theory, and the gaze. I sincerely hope that you enjoy. So shut your windows, lock your doors, and relax. It's time to delve into the depths of depravity. A bit of red paper should have just been slipped under your door. Do you dare to read it?
The phone number you are trying to reach is no longer in service. The new number is...
This must be what hell is like.
And now the news. Yesterday in Ashfield and the woods near Silent Hill, the bodies of five men and women were discovered. The police reported that all the murders appeared to be the work of the same perpetrator. They are continuing their investigation. Four of the victims were found dead at the scene, and the fifth victim, a Miss Eileen Galvin, was transported to St. Jerome's Hospital, where she died. Galvin's injuries matched exactly those of the other victims.
Where did you go? Hurry, save me!
Walter Sullivan, it's time to complete the 21 sacraments.
There's no avoiding it, of course. Room 302 is the beating heart of the game and where we will start today. It is where you always return to, where things slow down. What is home? Home is a resting place. Home is also tied to action. As Paolo Boccagni and Margareth Kusenbach argue, home is increasingly understood as a set of practices that make a place home-like. In other words, they continue, home is viewed as a particular form of doing that is performed by individuals in interactions with specific and imagined audiences. The expected skills and steps involved in doing home vary by gender, age, life stage, class, and many other structural variables. They are culturally constructed and legitimized, and they are taught and learned through various processes of socialization. For instance, in the household, in neighborhood and schools, yet also through consumption and popular media. Video games, therefore, can create the home, can construct those spaces just as surely as reality can, and Silent Hill 4 manages to achieve this very well, creating a set of repetitive circumstances wherein we begin to associate safety, comfort, and restoration, and by extension, the idea of the home, to Room 302. Room 302 is both the home of Henry Townsend and the home of the antagonist, Walter Sullivan. He's very close to home, as it turns out. But we'll get to that. Our first impression of Room 302 is one of total decay. The room itself is monstrous. It appears to be suffering externalized. It appears totally abject. Julia Kristeva, in her essay Approaching Abjection, defines abjection as having only one quality of the object, that of being opposed to I. The room is oppositional to us from the outset. Our expectations are tuned for bad things to happen. Blood, crusted like dried snot on the walls, curdles the veins and twists the stomach to witness. Things lie around, but they are unfamiliar to the touch and to the sight of both us as a player and our player character, who narrates things like, who are all these people, and who is this guy, to the photos on the wall. We are ultimately unsure of who we are playing as, which serves to create distance between us as players and our protagonist. Games are positioned well to create this kind of fear, that who we are playing as are not an extension of ourselves, but someone who could act against us, whether that be in gameplay or during a cutscene. And, as it turns out, this abject apartment functions on multiple levels. For, it turns out, we are playing as, if not a ghost, then a person soon to be dead, dragged into a nightmare realm. Joseph Schreiber, our false protagonist, given to us to defy expectations, also helps mediate the space around us. It is totally disgusting, but even the discernibly human objects beneath are unfamiliar. The space is foreign to us. We are invading someone else's space which has been coated in the gore of the other world. But it is a space that was once familiar to Joseph Schreiber. This was once his home. But he is living a waking nightmare, seeing beyond the veil of death and seeing that time has passed him by. In this way, the house is nostalgia turned upside down. Part of nostalgia's negative affect, as Wildschut et al. Describe, is the realization that some desirable aspects of the past are out of reach. I always like to extend the metaphor of nostalgia one step further within the context of what I work on, into the sphere of haunting. Schreiber is haunted by what has happened to his space, his home, but we don't figure out that we're playing as Schreiber until much later. So the player feels the abject discomfort in the moment. We feel in the moment, as Kristeva writes, a threat that seems to emanate from an exorbitant outside or inside, ejected beyond the scope of the possible, the tolerable, the thinkable. It is worth keeping Kristeva in mind, as her descriptions of the abject are relevant to a lot of this game, as I will show. A ghost tears itself from the wall, the first victim of our serial killer antagonist, and does something to Joseph which we are not privy to. This off-screen death and uncertain fate hooks us in, makes us want to keep playing. Then, we get our second impression of Room 302, as well as our own understanding of Henry Townsend. Henry is, well, boring. He's boring, but he's also a protagonist who we get a look at. I'm a bit dissatisfied with him on the one level. He is clearly intended as an audience surrogate of sorts. His blandness is, on the one hand, a cheap excuse to not write very much story for him. I must admit, I personally tend to err a bit on this side when it comes to Henry. I find that he could have had something more obviously compelling written about him, or at the very least had more genuine reactions to the various horrible things he witnesses throughout the game. You might argue that this makes him a more effective surrogate. I would tend to reply that this makes him a weaker character. In a series which has had such great characterization up until this point, we could interpret this as a pretty weird decision. But if we're to view this very charitably, we might find that his boring nature is the point. Character designer Naomi Hira says that for this title, we had a concept where we wanted to bring out the realistic, everyday aspects of the game. So the main character, Henry, isn't the super cool guy with anything special about him. We designed him to emphasize the idea of how he's an ordinary man you could find anywhere, who just happens to be living in this ordinary apartment. Henry is, much like Room 302 itself, a blank canvas. Grey walls with white trim, no decorations. Furnishings of no real personality, or particularly distinguishing quality. Henry is not exactly a vibrant interior decorator, nor with a particularly elaborate wardrobe. James's green jacket or Heather's vest seems a far cry from Henry's plain white shirt. Really, the only flair Henry has added to the apartment seems to come from his career. He's a bit of a photographer, and he's a good photographer too. He reflects on a photo of Silent Hill's church, that this is a photo of the church I ran across while I was visiting Silent Hill. For some reason, I was really attracted by the way it looked, so I took the picture. One might surmise that this gives him some personality. It does, but it's also a way for the developers to riff off of previous spaces, to reference previous games in the series, to build a world that isn't centered around a protagonist. This is something I didn't fully appreciate the first time I played, and the effect that it has on gameplay. In a way, Henry is an echo of other people. If we were feeling charitable still, this is a clever moment. If we are not, such references make Henry seem strangely empty. He muses at one point that he has lived an unsentimental life. Barely anyone in the apartment complex knows him. He has barely put down any roots. The apartment he spends most of his time in as an introverted shut-in barely reflects him, or reflects him rather too much. He's not very interesting, just like most of us, and in that way he reflects the reality of many players of the game. He also acts as a total outsider to the events of the plot, but he also barely has any proper reactions of his own. Yet, even an introvert should probably do more than gasp when he finds someone being murdered. His most dynamic in-cutscene moment occurs when he lunges forwards to try and save Richard Braintree from the electric chair. But it doesn't feel quite like enough to make up for a vacuum of personality throughout the game. In leaving that vacuum so obvious, though, the game developers left the space open for us to fill. Yes, he had an unsentimental childhood. Yes, he fears attachment or is very socially anxious. Perhaps because of that unsentimental childhood. Yes, he is interesting in that he is not your typical outspoken, proactive protagonist. He is useful in that he does not dictate to us how to feel in horrifying situations. Some horror protagonists in games, like the one in Outlast 2, swear and curse and yell every 2 minutes to try to influence how we feel. But often the opposite ends up happening. It's like a bad laugh track. So Henry's reticence to talk, his potential weaknesses and human failings, can make him interesting. But they also simultaneously work to flatten him, to make him distant from us. This is all to say that the apartment is not Henry's, so it inevitably becomes the player's. While I'm still reluctant to say completely that this was a truly deliberate, inspired choice, because I personally would have preferred just a few more details, just a few more concrete things to give to Henry, it does allow for us to take his space. And then, in the best moment, for Walter to take it from us, the player. The player-slash-character relationship is deeply complex and fraught in a number of video games. We often find ourselves relating stories of playing games in the first person. Oh, I fought these demon dogs. Then I went into an elementary school and I did this really cool piano puzzle. But there's also the understanding that it wasn't actually us who did those things. It was the avatar we control that did it. But then, we're also the one making that avatar do the things. Through a physical controller, we embody the character. It is worth noting the viewpoint from which we play the game. Up until this point, Silent Hill had not used a first-person perspective other than inside of cutscenes, such as when James passes out after fighting the Flesh Lips boss in the hospital in Silent Hill 2. But Silent Hill 4 utilizes the first-person perspective to fantastic effect. Silent Hill, as with a lot of classic survival horror games, give the player a voyeuristic impression. They achieve this through the detached camera angles that serve to provide, as Bernard Perron says in his book on Silent Hill, a perspective that no normal human could look at the events from. They are alienating and confronting. The camera angles serve several purposes. First, obviously, they allow the player to actually play the game. Second, they give the player themselves a feeling of distance from the character they are controlling, as well as providing that all-important feeling that the world itself is hostile to you. Finally, they make the player culpable in voyeurism, making us a horror movie director of sorts, culpable to all the terrible things that are going to occur to the poor characters in front of us that we are also controlling, potentially. These kinds of effects make a player feel a general sense of queasiness during certain unpleasant scenes. Horror provokes this kind of reaction all the time. Let's delve further into Kristeva's fascinating definition of the abject here. She writes that we can understand the abject in two forms, symptom and sublimation. There can be no abject without us, without an understanding of who we are and our own self-narratives. The sublime, the feeling that we are experiencing something greater than ourselves, almost seems to oppose the abject, the feeling of disgust and repulsion we can get from nauseating or horrifying experiences. We have to have an us for them to have an other. Kristeva says the symptom of the abject, a language that gives up, a structure within the body, a monster, a tumor, a cancer that the listening devices of the unconscious do not hear, for its strayed subject is huddled outside the paths of desire. This might be a bit much to wrap one's head around, but in simpler terms, we recognize the self embedded within the abject object. The abject is a part of ourselves that we recognize and fear all at once. Silent Hill 4's immersive experience within the room, where everything functions as we would expect it to at first glance, is calming and soothing, especially compared to what comes later. But Silent Hill 4 erodes the space's safety. It creates the abject. It grows a tumor, a cancer, within the cells of the house walls. It spawns evil. Silent Hill 4 takes this one step further with their first-person perspective, which places us directly in the shoes of a player character, a person, someone intended to be totally ordinary, and thus gives us a sense of ownership over the character and the space, as well as an incredibly personal relationship to the story. No longer are we so distanced from the character in these moments, so therefore we expect the sense of alienation to be gone. But, as it turns out, the room isolates both you and Henry together. Your interaction with other people while in the room is reduced to only the act of watching and listening. It is a completely one-sided interaction, and you are on the side of the spy, the pervert, and the lonely man in the apartment with a telescope or the camera. It's the horror of being unheard, forgotten, and unrecognized. Peering through the peephole shows you some people fussing in the corridor and bloody handprints on the wall. We consider this to be unconscionable behavior, but we also, through play, begin to accept it as part of understanding the game world, of creating a path to success. In Alexander R. Galloway's book, Gaming, Essays on Algorithmic Culture, he discusses the origins of the first-person perspective. The first-person perspective came from cinema, wherein, as Galloway says, the collection of visible evidence is often crucial in films, and the POV shot is commonly used to present to the audience evidence necessary to the film's narrative. Silent Hill 4 puts us into a first-person perspective to collect evidence and get closer to the character. Another academic, J.P. Talot, describes the 1947 film Lady in the Lake, saying that enigmatic detachment of course, as we both act and see ourselves in action, again typifies the dream experience. And this seems to summarize how Silent Hill 4 works, especially in a late game scene, where we peer through the peephole in the door and see a bloodied Henry Townsend staring back at us. The third person perspective provides detachment, while the first person perspective allows us to act directly as Henry, or ourselves. What should interest us most, however, in the realm of the visual is what Galloway calls the first-person subjective shot, which is used to show what Carol Clover calls predatory or assaultive vision, that is, a sadistic way of seeing characterized by aggressive action, forward movement, and on-screen violence. Henry Townsend might not be violently aggressive towards other human beings, but the voyeuristic element can be tied to the subjective shot, which is tied to assaultive vision. Henry's only way of interacting with the outside world is an outwardly hostile way, which is almost justified by the way the game is set up, with whenever you peer out of your window, you can see other people staring up at you sometimes. However, Galloway himself rebuts this by saying that in games, the first-person perspective is active rather than participatory. What was predatory vision in the cinema is now simply active vision. As far as identification is concerned, film failed with the subjective shot, but where film failed, games succeed. Where film uses the subjective shot to represent a problem with identification, games use the subjective shot to create identification. We have the opportunity to identify with Henry Townsend, as Galloway says, but at the same time, that makes us culpable in whatever actions that he takes. Electing to spy on Eileen, your beautiful neighbour, takes on a particularly sinister quality, considering you are the one in control, electing to see what she's up to when she does not know that you are watching her. The tiny peephole scratched through the wall also often prevents you from seeing Eileen's face, reducing her to just a body for half the game in these sequences. Of course, it's the amount of culpability you feel as you attempt to scratch elements of truth and knowledge from the game's story by doing whatever you can to find stuff out and obtain evidence. Your isolation and loneliness increase alongside Henry's, but any chance to get any closer to him is destroyed by the third-person camera perspective. Together, you are alone. Apart, you are isolated. You are always, in a sense, the voyeur in this game. The sinister element of the visual is that you are always an intrusion, no matter what sequence of the game you are playing. This makes you a horror element too, while increasing the disturbing atmosphere of the game for every second that you are playing, until the disturbing elements of the game feel stuck to the inside of your brain. Akira Yamaoka himself says that in his opinion, the first person is better. What I wanted to do this time is the closest thing to reality. After all, becoming a third-person game, you can draw things from the player's perspective. Interestingly, Yamaoka said, next time I want to see something that's from neither the first nor third-person perspective, which I find fascinating. I see Silent Hill as the perfect setting for standalone horror games, each connected by setting and general idea, but themes, scares, and experimental game design being used in each one. It is a shame that Silent Hill 4 spelled the end of Team Silent's time at Konami, as I can only imagine the fiendish experiments that would have been cooked up had the games not been handed off to other, more inexperienced developers. But let's refocus. There's so much to talk about in relation to Room 302 that the rest of the video will probably seem like a mere coda in comparison. But I wanted to talk about some individual elements of the room. Looking out the window, we can see a vista of people, somewhat reminiscent of writer Anne Edelman's description of looking out the window of her New York City apartment. From our kitchen window, I could look down a broad air shaft to the rear courtyard of my building. Across the way and to the left, dainty curtains hung above the small table where an old lady sometimes sat, alone, sipping tea. Above her and to the right, a child peered through safety bars, clutching the ears of a stuffed bunny. On sick days, I would look wistfully through my bedroom window into the windows of my school and watch insect-sized children, their little forms moving around the part of the classroom that was within my line of sight. How strange to see into a world, my world, from the outside looking in as things buzzed along without me, visible proof that I was not the center of the world I inhabited. This is an integral part of Silent Hill 4's feeling, how it functions. You are not the center of the world. Henry is not even the protagonist of the story. Walter is. Henry might save the day, but he's not the main guy in the story. People come to check on him, sure, but they just assume he's being weird. He's left to his own devices. Silent Hill 4 is almost a way of teaching the player that you're not the center of the world you inhabit. In fact, all my favorite games tend to evoke this feeling. You aren't the hero, you're just someone who happens to be there trying their damnedest for one reason or another. Horror is so good at this, it is no wonder I am so drawn to it so constantly. Now, the radio in this game is interesting, isn't it? In previous games, the radio was a tool for detecting monsters. In this game, it is exactly the same, though apparently Henry spent too much money on it to lug around and plug it into power outlets around the various worlds he visits to see if there are monsters nearby. The monsters in this game make enough noise anyway, I suppose. But the radio, placed away in the corner, is one of Henry's only portals to the outside world, to the quote-unquote real world. It is clear to me that the radio in this game is analogous to the radio I talked about in my video on PT. It is a window through to another world, a portal to a place we cannot access. There are some very human moments that come through the radio. In one, the game's director is said to be up a lamppost, pissing.
Police arrested a Mr. Saguru Murakashi after he was discovered naked, urinating from the top of a utility pole in North Ashfield.
Yet, much like PT, the radio in this game slowly loses the ability to communicate with the outside world. At a certain point, all the radio will play are loud bursts of irritating static. These bursts of static inform you that there is a haunting in your apartment. These hauntings are superb. They are ways of communicating directly to you that the space is no longer your own. We're meant to identify with Henry, to realize that our own space is slipping away from us. We can cleanse them with holy candles, which is an integral part of getting a good ending for the game. These hauntings turn up in the most innocuous of places, transforming even the coziest parts of the apartment into twisting nightmares. Take, for example, the armchair next to which is the save point. We scribble things in the journal to save our game, but in the latter half of the game, we might find that there is something beside the save point, draining our health. It is not obvious what it is until we place a holy candle down, performing the relevant cleansing ritual, and see that the chair is now made out of flesh. It is Silent Hill, no, horror, in microcosm. The idea that something that appears pleasant is actually foul is an integral part of many works of great horror. The hauntings are a way to subvert a space that we have come to know, come to be attached to, in a definite way. Spaces such as this, that are home to repetitive action, can be sacred, as Rachel Wagner describes in her article, This Is Not a Game, Violent Video Games, Sacred Space, and Ritual. She writes that human beings build sacred places and engage in sacred ritual as a way of projecting or enacting their own desire for meaning, their own hope that there is indeed a sacred or a real beyond worldly, profane existence. Similarly, people construct video games as a kind of sacred space into which they inject their wishes for how the world might work. Video game construction, like ritual performance, is a means of demonstrating desire, of mapping order, of developing rules for how to live. People who build sacred spaces are often making the claim, through their actions, that there is a sacred model, a real, that should be copied in this world. The encoding of rules into a game world, combined with the repetitive nature of Silent Hill 4 itself, helps to give Room 302 the sacred feeling that Wagner posits can be integral to a game's mood and how it leaves us feeling emotionally. Sacred space is a ritual space, a location for formalized, repeatable, symbolic performances. A description that sounds a lot like the arena of a video game, in which experiences are typically highly scripted and shaped, repeatable until the player gets it right in terms of the game's predetermined design for performance, they argue. We can make this sacred space our home as we repeat these holy actions over and over and over again. As we get up out of the bed, the room becomes more and more and more like home. But spaces can also be haunted, can't they? I spent the last year working on this YouTube channel and elsewhere to show that. As American sociologist Michael Mayerfield Bell suggests in his article The Ghosts of Place, we can use the word ghost to refer to felt presence, an anima, geist, or genius that possesses and gives a sense of social aliveness to a place. These hauntings, these ghosts, create elements of the abject, to be sure. Bell's article says that we see ghosts everywhere. We moderns, despite our mechanistic and rationalistic ethos, live in landscapes filled with ghosts. The scenes we pass through each day are inhabited, possessed by spirits we cannot see, but whose presence we nevertheless experience. The ghosts that we face through each world are connected to the suffering of a place, of events linked to those spaces, to the person who hurt them. Silent Hill 4 may be the most literally haunted of the Silent Hill games because of its use of ghosts, who monopolize the use of the word haunt. Avery Gordon writes that ghosts are becoming ubiquitous, that we are coming to understand the world in relation to the ghosts around us. I use the term haunting to describe those singular, yet repetitive instances when home becomes unfamiliar, when your bearings on the world lose direction, when the over and done with comes alive, when what's been in your blind spot comes into view. Haunting raises specters, and it alters the experience of being in time, the way we separate the past, the present, and the future. With that in mind, I turn now to Stephen Frosch, who analyzes the importance of the uncanny. Now, this is a topic that has been well mined, to say the least, and particularly when it comes to video games or animation, the uncanny valley, obviously. Frosch cites a part of Freud's 1919 essay on the uncanny, where Freud writes, I was sitting alone in my wagon-lit compartment when a more than usually violent jolt of the train swung back the door of the adjoining washing cabinet, and an elderly gentleman in a dressing gown and a travelling cap came in. I assumed that in leaving the washing cabinet, which lay between the two compartments, he had taken the wrong direction and come into my compartment by mistake. Jumping up with the intention of putting him right, I at once realised to my dismay that the intruder was nothing but my own reflection in the looking glass on the open door. I can still recollect that I thoroughly disliked his appearance. There's much to say about Freud, much to criticize and much to acknowledge about how dated his views on sexuality and gender are in particular, but there is still something relevant about the feeling he writes about here. Silent Hill 4, to say nothing of other horror games, use this effect a lot. P.T.'s coat hanger, exactly the same height as Lisa, the ghost antagonist, always gives me a double-take feeling, much as Freud writes about. We can have the same effect come through in Spaces. Frosch cites Gordon, who says that what is at stake here is the self made strange. Frosch writes about the unconscious fear, the shiver of coming face to face with something we can't quite recognize, saying, what is the unconscious here? Is it the past, back to haunt us? Or the future, threatening us with what we might become? Fear is, after all, usually directed towards what may happen, not what has already come to pass. That is more likely to be a matter for regret, though the fear that one may discover something about the past that will put the future in jeopardy is, surely enough, a haunting fear. What if we discover that the apartment that we live in is actually the vessel a serial killer intends to pour his life's work into? What if we discover that sleeping next to us is the crucified corpse of that same serial killer? How is the space reframed? What does it mean to be haunted? What is the truth behind the story? And do we have the strength to seek out that truth, regardless of how it will haunt us in the future? Frosch writes simply, ghosts will not let us alone. In Silent Hill 4, this is certainly the case. Ghosts are relentless, as are the hauntings. New, ugly perversions of a space we have come to love bubble to the surface constantly. Dolls broach the walls, like plague pustules forming and then being subsumed. A ghost of ourselves, throat slit, watches us through our own peephole, waiting for us to accept our own bloody demise. That peephole is seductive, alluring, and perhaps even addictive. We are addicted to looking. Otto Fenichel, in a now somewhat dated paper from 1937, writes that the symbolic equation to look at equals to devour. The idea might be familiar to you. If nothing else, Silent Hill 4 is a game about looking. The first-person subjective shifts create what Frosch identifies as an identificatory element to looking, a process of taking something in and becoming like it. He continues, saying that the desire to look instinct is a dual one, aiming to share and to devour. Looking involves appropriation. Conversely, being looked at means to risk having something taken away. We are empowered within Room 302 to be the one who spies on Eileen, forced to do it at least once, but the option always remains hereafter. We are the watcher, never ourselves able to be seen, but when the tables turn and the hauntings begin, there is something malicious in the game's revenge. We can gaze out the window and see all the others in the block across from us, but we can never touch them, nor can they see us. The head of a child abuser drifts lazily past the window, breaking the stillness, the power of one's uninterrupted gaze. Surveillance is turned against you. Walter points from across the way. You are interrupted on waking by a picture on your wall transforming into the possessive gaze of Walter Sullivan, mouth twisted into a grin or a yell. You are transformed by the claustrophobic terror of isolation, able to see but not be seen. Then when you are seen, the terror is abject. Unwanted, we flee from the visions of vision. Frosch writes that no contact is necessary, not even a conscious intention or attempt at communication, just a devouring glance that inserts something in the other and consequently poisons it from within, drying up its liquid, sucking out its inside. We are haunted by the quality that others have to poison with just their gaze. Photographs can be transformed into nightmares, and we can become paranoid from the breaking down of norms, the cries of a cat from the fridge, the washing machine coming to life and spraying blood all over the walls. When I take a dirty prisoner's shirt with a message written in wax to be washed in the blood of my bathtub, I am, strangely, not disconnected by the unreality of the action I am taking. The steps I take to solve that puzzle are relatively logical. The space feels homely and yet claustrophobic all at once. As the room degrades in quality, as 302 spirals out of control by degrees rather than by extremes, as other horror games might do. We as players are left to reckon with how the room is changing around us, piece by piece. The hole that opens up in our bathroom, an ugly gash in our own space that leads to other worlds, is a yawning portal from the known to the unknown. Slavoj Žižek, responding to the ideas of the gaze put forward by Jacques Lacan, a psychoanalyst who extended Freud's work, writes about the unsettling penetration of that vague something, the distorting presence, that does not fit into the world as we know it, sticking into our lives and disrupting its everydayness. This is the anamorphic, a term derived from optics, the surprise optical effects that distort, reflecting a strangeness to the everyday. Lacan was a Freudian psychoanalyst, born in 1901 and who died in 1981. Herman Rapoport, in his book Between the Sign and the Gaze, correctly identifies that Lacan was a man who privileged the image, and then takes it one step further. Rapoport writes that he would try to understand how, in the so-called act of psychoanalysis, the intervention of the analyst, one gains insight into the interrelation of word and image, their identification with and separation from one another at the very moment they come into correspondence. In other words, he was interested in the influence that the gaze could exert both ways, on both a real and symbolic level, both towards the thing one was viewing and the thing one was viewing staring back, being associated with something else. Room 302 is built around the anamorphic in its best, most subtle moments. A portal to other worlds is an effective image, a dreamlike thing which is relevant during times of isolation. We wish we could travel places, but for one reason or another we cannot. Laid low with depression, grief, or illness, we instead rely on metaphors and stories to comfort us. The portal takes us to horrifying places, but the dizzying strangeness of it is somehow reflective of our reality as we understand it. We recognize the abject. Lacan, in his essay, writes about what the gaze actually is and what it constitutes. For the purposes of this video, I refer to the gaze as a theoretical means by which we observe things and draw them into ourselves. As viewers, we are often protected from the gaze, he argues. We ourselves are gazing at a photograph, for instance, mastering it, but it is static, unable to master us. We can gaze at it, but it cannot gaze back. There is a barrier between us and the photo, however slight. But if we look at Societal 4 through Lacan's framework, when we consider the effect of Walter Sullivan's possessive gaze as he appears at the door, we understand that there may be rules breaking somewhere. Hal Foster writes about the impulse to erode the subject and tear at the screen, and Societal 4 certainly does this. But worse, Societal 4 summons the abject. The abject, the part of ourselves we recognize all too well but panic at the appearance of, the most intimate parts of ourselves that are also totally alien, is present in Room 302 at all times. It is our home, but it is not. It is our safe space, until it no longer is. The anamorphic is in the landline phone that rings even when the cable has been cut, in the television that plays static and, for split seconds, displays grotesque images of a ghost. The attachment we feel to Room 302, that intrinsic link, is haunting because of the lack of distance. That is why it is so easy to see ourselves in spaces, to possess them, and have them possess us, because the narrative distance is so small. As philosopher Gilles Deleuze writes, when a body encounters another body, or an idea another idea, it happens that the two relations sometimes combine to form a more powerful whole, and sometimes one decomposes the other, destroying the cohesion of its parts. We are subsumed by the room. We try to escape, but, like a maze or an addiction, the tunnel always leads back to our bed. We always wake up, possessed ourselves by the room. Henry leaves himself on the room. The room leaves itself on us. We are decomposed, broken. We are nothing before the room. The room would be nothing without us. It possesses us. We possess it. In a way, the room is all there needs to be. It haunts us totally. Gaze is explicit in this game. It cannot get any less subtle than the phone call a player can receive that states, "I'm always watching you," over and over and over again. We feel unsafe, insecure in our own home. Spectral surveillance unsettles us, makes us question what's real and what's not. The door, with its multiplicity of chains, is famous for a reason. It says, beyond a shadow of a doubt, you are not leaving. It says that this place has control of you. It's even signed by Walter himself. Don't go out. A more direct warning, a more direct challenge, the developers could not have made. People love Room 302, and for good reason. But to escape it, we have to travel to Room 302 of the past. As we wander through Room 302, switched to a black and white and red color palette, we are watching it now through a novel third-person perspective. We could say that this is the voyeuristic view that we are used to being weaponized against us. Instead of Henry peering at Eileen through the crack in the wall, or at the superintendent through the peephole, now the ghost of writer Joseph Schreiber, whose surname means writer, fittingly enough, watches us. The roles are reversed. Instead of Schreiber wandering through Henry's room 302, now we wander through Schreiber's. He watches us move through his space, as a once familiar place is made subtly different. The abjection is uncomfortable. We pick through, reading notes made for us. He is the perfect person to fulfill his part in the ritual. His early notes don't grasp this, but his later ones do. And Henry is the receiver of wisdom, made to understand the ritual in its fullness and the madness of what Walter wants to achieve. But for reasons that are fundamentally understandable, however warped they are, to psychosis and manipulation. Room 302 of the past is a place where we wander through a dead man's things, reading the notes he left for us, and receiving his spoken wisdom as he speaks with a monotone dead embedded in the ceiling. A more unusual scene could hardly be thought up, but it works its dark magic and its addictive nonsense, the sheer weirdness, making it infectiously enjoyable. We get our answers, some of them anyway, and the horror continues. We find a pickaxe of all things, and we go to make our escape. Finally, we can break free. Taking the pickaxe back to our room 302, whatever that means anymore, we crash it through the wall at the end of the corridor, next to the bedroom and the bathroom. This willful act of destruction reveals the corpse of Walter Sullivan, whose ghost crucified him above a portal to the underworld. His eyes are locked in our bedroom through the wall, his triumphant, almost heroic posture of self-crucifixion, a paradoxical view of serenity. Given that he has killed 19 people so far, and he has been trying his damnedest to kill us, and has an evil laugh to boot, there is nothing heroic about him. Yet, we understand him. The stench of his corpse, we can imagine, escapes the stale air of the small room and disperses throughout the rest of room 302. At last, things are laid bare. Returning to Michael Mayerfield Bell, he writes that we approach particular spaces with the ritual distance of a shrine because we treat them as we do persons. We sense in both spirits, ghosts, within. The experience of place is the experience of people, and for us, nothing can be more holy or unholy. The shrine of each individual is not always regarded as sacred, as Goffman noted. This quasi-religious presence may also be a profane one. What does Room 302 become at this revelation? Is it the final nail in the coffin for any comfort we can feel from the room? We shouldn't really be surprised, should we? Our first impression of the room is a blood-soaked hellhole. Yet, we come to find it a reassurance, thanks to how it functions in the gameplay. We always come back to it, and yet its power as a safe place is chipped away throughout the game. Objects and spaces are haunted by people. In the case of horror, it can be as literal as we want. Walter is literally inhabiting the apartment. His presence isn't metaphorical. He has seeped into this place, the stench of his corpse manifesting as a spectre, a grime. Room 302, I argue, subsumes us as players and turns the tables on us in subtle ways, so that when the game finally makes us truly uncomfortable again, just as it does with its opening barrage of the abject, we hardly recognize the room. Yet we also still recognize it intimately. We've spent so much time here, wandering down the tight hallway, gazing longingly at other people, and hatefully at the locked door. So when we find Walter's body, it is both a dramatic reveal and a quiet realization. The space is no longer our own any longer. It is yet another space colored by trauma, just another facet of Silent Hill. There is no escape from the room. The portal to the other world in the bathroom, though, seems to say otherwise. We claw our way through the tunnel and emerge into other worlds, seeing things through different eyes, our own. Yet the spaces are just as haunted as the room. There really is no escape. Room 302 is the anchor around which everything in this game revolves. It is one of the biggest reasons that I love this game so much. Because to exist in Room 302 is to exist in isolation and to watch as control is slowly taken away from you. To struggle against futility, to struggle righteously against an invading evil. When it comes to the idea of the home, we can, just like with monsters, create an us or them, or an inside and an outside, as Bacagni and Kusenbach argue. But in the case of Silent Hill 4, the evil was inside the room, inside us, all along. Subways seem to be a classic setting for horror. In terms of the rest of the Silent Hill series, Silent Hill 3 used them. Silent Hill Downpour would go on to use them too. Indie horror games love them because they're subterranean and repetitive, labyrinthian areas. The assets are easy to reproduce and reuse without much cognitive dissonance from a player. And yet, there are precious few horror games that actually manage to properly utilize a subway world and make it both scary and fun. Sadly, Silent Hill 4 does not exactly manage it perfectly.
No!
Subway World is the player's first traditional survival horror level. Here we encounter Cynthia, a woman who has no idea what is going on. Are we dreaming? Are we a part of her dream? Is she a part of ours? We've already seen a woman go into the subway from our window, but are we awake or asleep in the apartment? What exactly constitutes reality in a game made up of vignettes like this? We wander through a world defined by others. In this specific instance, the subway world is a part of Walter Sullivan's other world. He used the subway to reach the apartment that he believed was his mother. He never had a proper understanding of his parents, and so he returned to his origin point, the place where he was born that he has convinced himself is his mother. The subway is connective tissue, the place that stitches worlds together. The choice to open the survival horror proper with a subway level is certainly interesting, particularly as it is finicky to move through. Why don't I put the coin in the coin machine? Why do I put it in the turnstile? Why, Henry? Train cars sit abandoned and malformed. As is customary for Silent Hill's otherworld, something has happened to them, as they are warped by the extreme delusions of the man whose mind begat them. Weird grey tissue coats the floor, sticky sounding like glue. Mannequins are posed like corpses. There are things that cannot be explained. The real connective tissue is the enormous worm-like creature, known as the Greedy Worm according to the wiki, who can be seen at several points not just in this level but in the game, the enormous umbilical cord of Walter Sullivan drawing him back to his mother, cycling down, 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 always down. The creature cannot be harmed in any real way, nor does it appear in every level, but the fact it reoccurs is enough for me. It's almost inherently silly. This enormous worm that permeates realities. But it also contains enough truth about the human psyche, even offhandedly, to be worth mentioning. Threads of memories are subconscious, triggered by things that seem to be almost totally random. Thoughts, consciousness, is a rush. The subway is populated by monsters and ghosts together. The two different types of enemies reoccur throughout the entire game. Monsters can be killed permanently. Ghosts cannot. Ghosts suffer endlessly. Monsters are allowed to die. Cynthia is a much easier person to escort around than Eileen will become. Cynthia will teleport to the rooms you enter. She's much faster and she cannot be killed before her time. At least, I don't think she can. She's a juxtaposition, a tutorial and a warning all in one. Her brutal murder is inevitable, no matter how quickly you run, no matter how many speedrunning tricks you include in your repertoire. An almost endless escalator looms, dreamlike. It is, perhaps, my least favourite part of this game. The wall men, as they are known, spring like ulcers from the gums of this place, and strike Henry back with unrelenting force. It just sucks. There's nothing I can say to really make it any more tolerable. Henry's refusal to target the right enemy makes first playthroughs almost physically painful. It is, fittingly to my simile, like pulling teeth. Yet, the image of an enormous escalator has real power. The idea that we are marching onwards to an inevitable encounter, drawn there technologically, but in a dream, is a good one. It is a shame that it goes hand in hand with the dull, frustrating subway. As we wander the maze-like, headache-inducing subway, my thoughts are drawn to Nicholas Intrakin in his book The Betweenness of Place, Towards a Geography of Modernity. Intrakin writes about the importance of socially constructing spaces. As an example, he writes that we live our lives in place and have a sense of being part of place, but we also view place as something separate, something external. A neighborhood is both an area centered on ourselves and our home, as well as an area containing houses, streets, and people that we may view from a decentered or an outsider's perspective. Thus, place is both a center of meaning and the external context of our actions. In this instance, the subway has different meaning for every person who plays it. Speaking as someone who has had rare encounters with subways in real life, the subway is not a pleasant place to be. Our frequently noted ability to socially construct places is a particularly modern view that recognizes our freedom to create meaning. Such a view highlights the active agent and the societal constraints on action, but does not overcome the basic tension that exists between the relatively subjective existential sense of place and the relatively objective naturalistic conception of place, Intrakin argues. Horror is filled with this freedom to create meaning, this modern conception. There is a tension between our objective reality that we see and the subjective reality that we create. The subway, for Walter Sullivan, is a miserable place, a transitory place. The trains move slowly or are stalled and broken. The mannequins are hollow facsimiles of people. He doesn't see them properly, not really. When Cynthia transforms into a mannequin covered in blood, frozen in a position of vulnerability, there's a bit of confusion, sure, but also a cold chill. Walter is demonstrably misogynistic. He reserves his worst, most brutal killings for his female victims. Not to say that the other victims get off lightly either, but Cynthia is stabbed countless times. The girl, a Kane twin, in the backstory is hacked to death slowly and painfully, whereas the boy is killed in one strike. There is nothing in this place but the horrific distortions that a man sees his world through, yet it remains recognizably a subway. We know it is, yet the peril of such a place is that it can start to imprint on us too. Horror media that leaves us with weird fears or thoughts about common places or things, even if just for a few nights, are fascinating. Traumatic experiences, had in this instance within entirely safe spaces, controllable by us at all times, just switch off the power at the wall. What's Walter going to do about that, huh? Can still have a serious impact on us. The reason I remain attracted to horror, even after years of immersion within it, is because it always has something new to impart. The stuff we willingly subject ourselves to, why do we do it? We have a need to tell stories about ourselves, but horror upsets those stories. Horror makes us look at ourselves in a new light. Horror encourages self-reflection. The role of narrative is integral to how we view space. We self-narrativize, imprinting ourselves on spaces and concepts, leaving our fingerprints behind everywhere we go. In the case of Silent Hill 4's miserable subway, it is a pretty underwhelming place to start the survival horror game proper, if you ask me. The main issue comes across from its disjointed approach, but which also emphasizes the game's deliberately repetitive approach. It's mind-numbing in a way, particularly when the more traditional survival horror level that we're playing through is colorless and also really without any function or challenge. An additional problem is that it lacks the subtle feeling of reality provided by Silent Hill 3's also somewhat controversial subway section, but which I love much more than 4's. Most enemies can be swiftly dodged, for instance, and unlike the early sections of the previous games, which lather on a lot of careful atmosphere, it feels like comparatively very little time to get settled into the actual rhythm of the differences between Room 302 and Subway World. You meet Cynthia, she feels sick immediately and goes into the bathroom. Henry waits for a while, then the sniffer dogs come through. The sniffer dogs, let me just take a minute, are such fantastic enemies. They actually have some level of robustness to their behavior. They'll ignore you provided you don't run from them, showing fear, or get too close. They'll also go over to fallen enemies and, using their proboscises, will actively suck them dry, consuming their internal organs. They also have these great cat-like growls that just somehow doesn't fit at all, but also fits perfectly. One of those dissonant, uncanny moments, just like we talked about before, where things are similar but just unexpected enough to provoke discomfort. Horror and humor, the classic hand-in-hand dance. Some enemies in this game do, in fact, provoke laughter with their weird, uncanny noises, but also nausea. But that's for later. In spite of all this negativity, there's still something actually beautiful beneath the frustrating escalators and the tedium of running back and forth down overly maze-like subway cars dodging ghosts. Maybe this is merely a form of Stockholm Syndrome talking, the countless hours spent playing this game over and over again, but when the ghost of Cynthia claws her way weeping from the depths of the subway, and Henry's face finally contorts into something resembling actual human emotion, however subdued, there's a moment of clarity. That the people Walter has killed are here to suffer over and over again. That the pain they feel is what you feel, trekking back through these worlds, Eileen in tow, repeating the same actions over and over again. Perhaps in some way, horror shattered me and my expectations for video games. Because a certain level of masochistic suffering is expected now, some pain to make the experience more enjoyable, more profound. If that is what the subway is doing, then it does its job well indeed. The game's first half and its rhythm is firmly established here. You wander a world that is inhabited by you and one other person, and each of these other people are murdered at the end of it, in uniformly gruesome ways. And at the end of this world, it's not long before we're sent speeding off to... The interesting thing about Forest World is how it is partitioned. Survival horror games from the era are divided up into discrete rooms, each one broken off from the other by a loading screen, which is typically provided by a door or some other passage one must interact with. You'd imagine a forest would have more of a fluid, open feel. Capcom's Haunting Ground from 2005, a year later than Silent Hill 4, has a relatively open forest area. There are no obvious breaks or partitions in the environment in that game, but Silent Hill 4, on the other hand, creates a weird, disjointed forest. Some rooms are shaped more naturally when you're playing in them, but the map is divided into discrete squares for the most part. The forest itself is about as Silent Hill as you can make a forest, with fences and barbed wire obstructions stopping natural exploration. Forests, the natural environment, should be a freer environment. But Silent Hill as a construct still transforms it into something rigid. Rising up out of the forest is an industrial-looking building. It is oblique, almost tortured in appearance. Swarms of the groaner bats emerge from the depths, all the while Henry's footsteps clank, clank, clank against the floor. There's something surreal about the place. Something long abandoned yet inhabited by monsters creates once again a feeling of isolation. Human beings within Silent Hill are so often repulsive, people who we don't want to stay with. But the monsters are never a comfort either. The forest is certainly populated by enough of the monsters. It is relentless with the number of enemies that appear, but they can just be moved past. What's the difference between the horror that takes place in the wilderness versus within civilization? Silent Hill 4 essentially dodges that important question and positions the forest as corralled, captured, and defined. The square cells, lined with fences to delineate the boundaries of each quote-unquote room, all build towards the heart of the forest, which is the orphanage where Walter was abused for years and years. The forest rooms are peppered with wells, too. These wells are dark portals, but they can be illuminated on a second visit. Shining a flaming torch down on them, a player can find the scattered parts of a mannequin. This is probably the dumbest puzzle in the game. The one that feels the least necessary. You have to run around and find all of these mannequin parts hidden within these wells. All that happens when you assemble it is that the mannequin wheels itself out of the way on its wheelchair. Gee, how do I get past this? Boy, I don't know, Henry. Maybe try push it out of the way, There's not even the opportunity to attempt that, which I would have liked. Henry impotently pushing against a wheelchair would have been a fantastic image. The other interesting thing about Forest World is probably just how close we get to the rest of Silent Hill. Walter inadvertently, or perhaps purposefully, ends up scorching the orphanage he was abused at when he kills Jasper. Jasper is an occult enthusiast who is investigating the deaths of his friends who were killed by Walter previously. Walter claims another victim and also attacks the trauma of his past while doing it. Say what you like about the man, but that's what we call efficiency. We can stand on the cliffside looking out at Toluca Lake, but that's as close as we get. It's much like the pictures in Henry's apartment, come to think of it. Silent Hill itself is there, but a shimmering illusion we have to squint to see, or whose vision disappears at the corner of our eye. It is a nostalgic tease, perhaps, a showcase of how the game really operates. Walter, after all, is the last hope of the cult to summon their god. Dahlia reaching out from beyond the grave yet again, manipulating yet another person. The first four Silent Hill games in particular are tied together by themes of abuse, of how it can create cycles that extend beyond the grave. Jasper is a victim of this abuse. Desiring to know more about the deaths of his friends, he winds up getting too close to the truth and dying because of it. Dahlia is the center of this abuse, the dark religion from a small tourist town spelling the death of countless innocents, even after she dies. Alessa's abuse begets the other world, which begets trauma of all kinds. Walter's abuse began in the forest, in the orphanage. The orphanage is the heart of the area, where all branches connect. One of the most curious methods of story delivery I've ever seen comes from the stones scattered around the forest world, where Eileen will slowly pass the text left by a child Walter talking about the abuse he suffered there. The vulnerable can be exploited for their own ends. Silent Hill as a series is a warning about that abuse. Everything repeats, doesn't it? We go through each world twice, we bounce back and forwards between the twisted other worlds and our slowly twisting home. Room 302 takes on more qualities with the other world as we discussed, becoming worse and worse as the game progresses. We take Walter with us, home. We carry his fears on our shoulders. Forest World's best bit, other than Jasper's endless bottle of chocolate milk, is the puzzle that again calls upon cycles. We unearth a blood-rusted key that causes us to walk through the same cell over and over again. I've seen some players not notice for quite some time. It's fascinating how automatic the movement becomes. It becomes almost ritualistic, going through the same door over and over again. When the player does notice that something's amiss, it's like they're waking up from a dream. "Oh," they say, "that's strange. I thought I'd be back to the middle by now." We're still at a point in game discourse where trauma theory has yet to really latch on properly. There's still much to learn and very much to identify. This video might be lacking in that regard because there's not much game theory to latch on to support what I'm saying. But the wilderness of the forest world is not wilderness. It's corralled, pressed into little boxes, compartmentalized. Walter gripping at the abuse with his fragile mind, chasing you through the woods with his chainsaw and his pistols, laughing all the while. This was the place where he spent much of his childhood, abused and traumatized by a cult that cared not for him as an individual, but for him only as a member of the cult. Philosopher Jack Derrida identified that fictional narrative could be oddly specific, that it can incorporate the specifics of other languages but suspend their meaning. Thus, literature's being suspended means that we can play with all forms of information by temporarily bracketing rules of discourse, as Roger Luckhurst writes. Trauma is itself a specific thing that can be suspended, and has become part of the language of all kinds of media, horror or not. Trauma is everywhere in texts, something many of us reckon with. Trauma was and is subject to much debate, but particularly in the memory wars in the 1990s, where scholars were arguing whether we could repress traumatic episodes and keep them buried only in the subconscious. Silent Hill, of course, is a series about the stuff that people do repress, and the actions we need to take to unearth those traumas from the subconscious, whether our own or other people's. More than just the subconscious, the game's plots are instructive of how characters move on from the trauma they have experienced. The thing that complicates games is what Espen Arseth calls ergodic, that is, to produce a meaningful experience, they require a non-trivial effort from an actively participating player who is given a sense of agency within the fictional world. To get the full experience, in other words, we need to really stick into survival horror. we need to challenge ourselves to get a challenge from the game is to get a more impactful narrative experience. And as Luckhurst writes, trauma is no longer something that can only be understood to come from war. Adult survivorship of unremembered childhood abuse holds out the greatest possibility of universal experience among such stories. It is easy to understand how Silent Hill can impact on us more profoundly than other texts, because, being a game which requires significant effort to beat, we naturally become more invested in the game and the events that unfold within it. A non-trivial effort indeed is required, and the more immersed we get, the deeper the understanding obtained is. Sean Travers writes about trauma narratives that one of the goals of mainstream trauma narratives is to convey or transmit affect onto the reader the experiences of their protagonists, to employ experimental forms so as to make the reader feel, as close as possible, the symptoms of traumatized characters. We are made to feel traumatized within horror games. That is part of their effectiveness, at least, when they work. As we hear about Walter's various abuses from Eileen, because Henry can't read his handwriting, as Eileen is drawn closer to Walter's way of thinking and being after the abuse doled out to her at his hands, the cycle continues. We understand how Walter ended up the way he did, but it doesn't give him an excuse necessarily. We are made to feel the way he did, a sense of hopelessness that the odds are stacked against us, but it doesn't always quite work in this game. The enemies are a bit too easy to avoid. The puzzles are a tad too simple to solve, or too frustrating to bother immersing yourself with. Eileen can be a bit slow to catch up in Forest World for whatever reason. Sometimes she has trouble going through certain doors in this world, whereas I rarely had problems elsewhere. The longer you leave her in a room with enemies, the more damage she takes, and the more possessed by Walter's spirit she becomes, the more willing she becomes to sacrifice herself for him at the end of the game. But I didn't abandon her on purpose. Nonetheless, despite these frustrations, the intent was there, I think. We're supposed to feel the same claustrophobic trauma that Walter did, but it only really works as it is supposed to, at least consistently, within two places for me. Room 302, as we've already discussed, and Water Prison World.
God said at the time of fullness, cleanse the world with my rain. Gather forth the white oil, the black cup, and the blood of the ten sinners. Prepare for the ritual of the Holy Assumption.
Easily my favorite of the various worlds in Silent Hill 4, Water Prison World captured my imagination immediately. It is such a fantastical realm for horror to be situated in, an enormous bloody stone tower rearing up out of the ocean. The prison is a panopticon, a place where you can be viewed at all times. There is no privacy, no safe hiding spot, no corners in which you can hide. The circular passageways demand your continued movement, and there is always a new corner around which an enemy can hide. I have shown many people the Water Prison World segment, giving them the controller as they enter into the starting cutscene, because I think it encapsulates the experience of the third-person segments of Silent Hill 4 the best. It is certainly, in my opinion, its best showing. The leech creatures known as Tremors are a perfect litmus test for how people react to the grotesque or the discomforting. I've had people insist on smashing every single one of the leeches, hitting them off the walls and stomping resolutely atop them, turning them into fine paste beneath Henry's boot, for no reason other than they were gross. Other people merely tried their best to ignore them. A few others spent time lingering, watching their random patterns of movement as they slithered up walls and fell from the ceiling. The moment, though, that I always savored was the third floor of the building. A player, up until this point, has never encountered the twin victim monster, the monstrous representation of two children that Walter killed. They are eerily still. Unlike some of the other monsters in the game and the rest of the series, they don't move towards you immediately upon spotting you. Instead, they are content to stand and point, their finger tracking you accurately as you watch them. They whisper, almost impossible to hear, until you lean forwards, "Receiver, receive." And, without fail, this moment has always made people jump. as they round the panopticon corner and see the twin victim, there is always a split-second take, or even a jump, and, more than once, serious profanity. The breathless fuck is always a joy, because I remember feeling exactly the same way when I first played through the game. It's a wonderful moment. It's a wonderful moment because the game, all through Water Prison World, is confident enough to let the player experience horror for themselves. There's no slow panning shot around the corner, no cutscene that lets the player know that whatever happens next, the outcome is out of their hands, so they can relax a bit. No, the effect of this sequence in Water Prison World serves to erode the player's sense of safety. Played or ludic horror, it's very easy to undermine by doing silly things like overly telegraphing moments, or dictating to the player when they should be afraid. But by making the horror emergent, even better, by making the scares a direct result of player decisions to go and investigate a dark or creepy place, fear is more effectively built, and the game creates a much more effective memory in the player. I love these moments because they feel personal to me, because I dictated when I went to confront the monster around the endless corner. When I am the one making those kinds of decisions, things only get better. And speaking of getting better, some players opted to just quit and turn off the game there. Fine, sure, I understand that. Not everyone's a horror person. But those who stayed were greeted with an even better realization that the twin victims can run. And they can run fast. The expectation is that the bigger a monster is, the slower that they're going to move, right? But the twin victims running on their enormous hands are much, much faster than they have any right to be. And that's what shocks people. The sight of them standing there pointing, that's jarring, that's confronting, and is a test of a player's bravery. But I have seen even the braver players crumble and cry out in surprise as the twin victims barrel towards them, their enormous hands clomping along the ground. What a joy it is to share horror games with others. I refer to the first appearance of the twin victims as, quote-unquote, that moment in Silent Hill 4, where the magic of emergent horror in video game form clicks. Silent Hill 4 even manages to replicate this trick. When a player revisits Water Prison World later in the game, they enter into a wide corridor, which is lined with what must be 6 or 7 twin victims. They all just point and stare, confronting the player with the inevitability that they must somehow be confronted, must somehow be fought. An increasing sense of dread is made effective this time by the knowledge that yes, play against these horrifying monsters is inevitable, but also by pre-established notions that these bastards are fast, and they don't go down that easily. Horrifying play becomes more horrifying in situations where you know you have to confront the monster, and it is even more effective when you know the monster in question is dangerous. For me, that moment is a priceless reminder. A reminder that, despite some people's understanding of horror films and other older forms of horror, that a played interactive experience wherein the player is trusted to make the decisions that will lead them cleverly to a genuinely frightening experience is powerful and novel. That moment remains one of my favorite things to share with people, a moment to luxuriate in. But only through trusting the player, even if it is carefully guiding them through a linear or mostly linear level, can truly effective and confronting ludic horror be created. There's also something to be said for the use of perspective in Water Prison World. That second encounter a player has is also foreshadowed by the weirdness of the corridor that it's in. In your first visit, you can open a door and enter into a massive room. There's a door that's so large you couldn't possibly reach the handle to open it, let alone push it open. But when you return later with Eileen in tow, the corridor has stretched, meaning a longer walk. But also, thanks to the shift in perspective, the door is now the right size. It's one of the smartest uses of perspective I've come across in video games. I'm still a really big fan of it. So let's return to the trauma question for a moment that I brought up in the last section. As we established, there's a lot of trauma baked into the game.
Toby Smethurst
writes eloquently and helpfully about this matter, saying, "Most notable in the field of literary or cultural trauma theory is the work of Kathy Carruth, whose edited collection Trauma, Explorations in Memory established the pattern that cultural trauma research would follow for at least the next 10 years. For Carruth, the defining characteristic of the traumatic flashback is the fact that it cannot be understood by its victim, even as it provides a supposedly faithful image of the original traumatic event. The flashback or traumatic reenactment conveys, that is, both the truth of an event and the truth of its incomprehensibility. According to Carruth, once the trauma is put into words, it risks losing both the precision and the force that characterizes traumatic recall. The troublesome implication is that working through or trying to address the trauma directly actually betrays the truth of the traumatic event, and as such, the only real trauma is an unprocessed one. Because of this, the reality of a traumatic history can only be perceived in unassimilable forms. In cultural trauma theory, therefore, it becomes the writer's or filmmaker's ethical responsibility to find the unassimilable form through which the impact of trauma can be effectively conveyed to the audience without dissipating its truth. So, if we were to consider a horror text in this light, the metaphorical other worlds of Silent Hill are ways to show the non-specific, unprocessed truth of trauma. In another way, the horrible sights we see in another world are non-specific, but still recognizable metaphors for certain traumas that characters have been through. The power of metaphor is its ability to connect with more people than just a straight story. Through allegory, we can imprint more of ourselves on the story being told, imagining ourselves in the shoes of characters, done even more powerfully, of course, in video games, where we are forced to engage with the game itself, guiding the game to its conclusion through concerted effort, ergodic, just like we talked about before. What a prison world is so terribly isolating, a tower built out on the sea. In terms of metaphor, it is the leaky prison near the orphanage that Walter was abused within. The abuser, Andrew DeSalvo, meets his end in the waterlogged basement and haunts it again as a spectre. A note from a child says that they wish to stick the sword through the pig's stomach. DeSalvo is that pig, and the only ghost that you must pin down in the whole game in order to recover a key from his body. Alongside Cynthia, he's probably the creepiest ghost in the game as he sings some murderous tune to himself. Much like Jasper's murder destroying an old site of abuse, this time we vicariously defeat an enemy for Walter, fulfilling our antagonist's childhood dream for revenge. It is a mechanical marvel in some sense. What a Prison World contains about the one traditional Silent Hill puzzle in this game. The puzzle's difficulty is affected by the difficulty you chose, probably because there's only this puzzle that's really affected, at least as far as I'm aware, but I always found it weird that after the great puzzle action difficulty levels of 2 and 3, they just dropped the concept and merged them again. Oh well. It's worth reflecting on the ghost or enemy introduction cutscenes, the rare few that appear. They are flickering, grainy, and look pretty horrible, but that's the aesthetic charm of them. The importance of film grain is that it enhances the reality of an image we see, whether or not the image is real or not. It's been found to have that effect, adding authenticity to it. The grimy authenticity of the game's presentation contrasts with Henry's stilted appearance, but everything works in concert to create an atmosphere of real dread, particularly within Water Prison World. The top of the tower is just exquisitely beautiful, a well-thought-out mechanism that you activate, pouring water down to activate the gears, which you can funnel through the right pipes in that puzzle. The fog drifts around. On the second visit, you descend a huge elevator to reach the top of the tower. What an inspired choice. It shows the impossibility of it all, the surreality of the scenes you have seen laid bare before you. That a tower, all alone in the middle of the ocean, is connected to the other worlds by the sky? What a gorgeous, gorgeous idea. It is, as Frederick Jameson describes, a mesmerizing lost reality, a particular thing gone by. In Silent Hill's various other worlds, what we have is a simulacra of a character's trauma. The semiotics of Silent Hill is why people keep talking about it. They do not seek to recreate trauma as it is or was actually enacted for Walter. Sure, they do a lot of things that are recognizable, but things are just off enough, creating the abject again, that the prison once used for orphans is now a totally isolating place for adults, infested with monsters that grow from walls and leeches that spiral half-heartedly on the ceiling. The isolation that Walter felt, those are the signs and symbols Water Prison World is built of. And while it's the most abstract and unusual of all the worlds, it isn't a subway, nor an orphanage, nor an apartment block. It is the most frightening and the most effective in provoking a sense of dismay, I find. There is no safety in the cells. You can always be watched. As a shadow draws across the light, accompanied by footsteps, you realize you cannot escape the torment so easily. The screams in here echo around the walls, the coarseness of the stone somehow real beneath Henry's feet, the struggle to survive, punctuated by endless holes that you leap down over and over again. Just another sick cycle of abuse, another repetition. If Silent Hill had to end here, it would have been well served. Everything is stitched together, the halls are circular, the cells are all the same, there can be no walking back, not even when you have a look of serenity on your face as you plan your reunion with your mother. The story is of blood dripping into the water, forever changing it. I am not a big city person. I've always disliked the idea of the concrete jungle. I've been to a few of them in my time, and while they're not bad to live in for a little while, as a tourist, I don't think I could handle life without more greenery than buildings. But regardless of my own biases, Building World is this massive, horrible block of grey. Its map is almost indecipherable, and it is just generally unpleasant to look at, to wander around, and to exist inside of. In that regard, I think we're back to the quality of Subway World, at least for the most part. Building World does have a few really great moments that distinguish it from Subway World, particularly on the first visit. The second visit is slightly more tiresome to complete legitimately. There's an easy to pull off glitch that skips a large back and forth inventory item hunt puzzle, and it feels like both a relief and a dirty cheat. Probably because it is, but you know, sometimes on a replay, one just can't be bothered with any more fetch quests. The best parts of Building World are the bar and the long staircase up and down. The bar is great because not only do you get the rusty axe here, the best or most abusable weapon in the game, bar none. The puzzle here is great. The door code is 4 digits from the phone number of the bar visible on the billboard, but you can't see the billboard from the bar because it's on the roof. But wait, there is one window you know you can look out of. So you go through the tunnel, you return to room 302 and you look out the window and there it is. This is just so delightfully clever, in such a pathetically simple way, that I still find myself joyous whenever someone figures it out for themselves when I show them the game. It's such a great little puzzle because it plays on perspective and reinforcing room 302 as your home. It links back to the best idea the game has, the gaze, the act of looking. I think that is the idea that PT played on the most, isn't it? The idea that looking is one of the most powerful and also disempowering things we can do. Looking at these horrible sights, the things that ingrain themselves in our minds, that is the important thing. Because the combat just isn't that interesting here. The ape creatures, known as gumheads, are okay, I guess. The symbolism is pretty obvious. Walter thinks other people are stupid, just like apes, and they appear in great numbers. But the moment you get your hands on the axe and appreciate the power of the charge attack, no enemy can stand before you. It gives you precious invulnerability frames as you perform the long swing, meaning that once you master the art of backing up a little and then swinging, almost any enemy is a sucker for it. Nothing can cancel you out of it. The rusty axe gives you the powers of invulnerability. It's also worth considering that the rusty axe is probably the axe that Walter used to kill the two children who would become the twin victim monster. So that's a nice grim detail, I think. But the building world is labyrinthian. I like it, but it can also become quite frustrating before you've learned where you need to go and what order you need to tackle things in. It works better than apartment world, which I don't really like, because it doesn't require the same level of backtracking, at least on the first visit. It doesn't have as many item hunts that feel frustrating or obtuse. But that's all subjective. Building World's labyrinthian nature is also recognizably rooted in the architectures we know and understand, the things that we appreciate. There's very little to say about it that's uniquely interesting beyond the vignettes, the things that Walter remembers. He murdered someone at the pet shop and at the store. The seemingly endless staircase is a reminder of how small the apartment complex likely made him feel, and is also a way to annoy the player, and call back to the other endless staircases in previous games, particularly the 1 and 2. If Silent Hill 1 and 3 are linked, 2 and 4 also have a strong link, though obviously not as strong, as 1 and 3's link. But after the building world, we get the thematically similar...
I'm always watching you. I'm always watching you. I'm always watching you.
I'm not really a fan of the first visit to Apartment World, mainly because I feel the environment is strangely unengaging to explore. Perhaps because there's little fear to be found here. There is much of the abject about the place, certainly, and the uncanny, but there's little scary going on here, I find. When you compare it to the atmospheric, iconic, claustrophobic apartment block in Silent Hill 2, or the nasty schoolhouse in Silent Hill 1, which both have fairly similar layouts, those feel different, more potent. The sound design is more robust, the scares more effective. Generally because the apartments in Silent Hill 4 feel too well-known, well-charted. The enemies rarely hide, the ghosts here are fairly easy to avoid, and the camera angles can be a bit frustrating here for me in ways that fixed camera angles rarely make me feel. I normally love fixed camera angles, but there's something about them here that doesn't work. Another problem is everything is so well lit. Taking away the flashlight means that everything, by necessity, has to be well lit, and without the darkness, it's much harder to scare. Not impossible, but much harder. The best part of the otherwise frustrating apartment world, though, is what you learn about the complex you are living in. Given that Henry is a shut-in and the most contact we have with people outside of the apartment is by looking at them, the appropriating, objectifying gaze again, then there is definitely something to be said for the way that Henry learns about these people by snooping through their apartments, looking at their things, appropriating their stuff. We look at the paintings done by a woman who enjoys painting other people in the apartment building. We see the pornographic magazines stacked high on the table of a pervert who had to get beaten up and stripped of his clothes to learn a lesson. We see the superintendent's apartment and the things people lose or forget. We meet Walter here, though we don't know he's Walter yet, and he offers us a doll. He recounts about the doll that I got this from Miss Galvin a long, long time ago. She was younger than me back then. This weird line might be referencing the fact that he's dead now and she's older than he is. She looks so happy holding her mother's hand, he continues. Here, I'll give it to you. In other words, Eileen's kindness made such an impression on him, perhaps the one person who was genuinely nice to him, without any expectation for repayment, that he not only kept the doll, he decided that she'd be perfect to fulfill the role of the mother reborn. That kindness she showed him when she was a child was enough to be marked in his mind as worthy of that role, as a sacrifice. The doll is famously a trick. Put it in your item chest back in room 302, and you get a super special haunting, the dolls coming under the wall. But I don't know. Other than the fact we're getting lots of cool things about the other residents of the apartment, there's not much to recommend it or to talk about, at least to my mind. It's a slow, boring area gameplay-wise, with the red paper item hunt being overly vague and at least a little bit frustrating to find in basically every playthrough, no matter how many times I play through this game. That's a me problem, I suppose. But it also feels like a problem with how Silent Hill 4 telegraphs information, and maybe this is the point of the game where the repeated trips back to room 302 can feel a bit exhausting. You have to pick up bits of red paper and slip them under the door, but because this game, unlike previous entries in the series, has limited inventory space, there's a bit of unnecessary item juggling in this repetitive section. Yes, it's an apartment block, it's meant to look samey and identical, but there's no interesting changes to the environment or anything really scary going on. Silent Hill 2's apartment block is pitch black. Until you get the flashlight, James refuses to touch or pick up anything that's shrouded in darkness. Henry doesn't have a flashlight, so the Ashfield Heights apartments by necessity can't be dark. Henry also doesn't have a radio, so enemies are made to be deliberately more visible as you enter an area, perhaps to counter frustrations that Team Silent might have thought people were going to experience in this area in particular. But the apartment in South Vale in Silent Hill 2 feel evil, with each room uniquely abandoned and left to rot in believable ways. It's hard until four meat moss stretches across whole stretches of the corridor. Everything feels well lit, and, most importantly, confrontable or avoidable. Enemies fall like wheat before the scythe, rusty axe, and I just can't really fathom being frightened by this area, even though it should have the same repetitive effect that Southvale's apartments had on me. But there's something missing, and it wasn't just Silent Hill 2 that had this mysterious missing quality. The other preceding games in the series had a real sense of danger about them. But at this point in Silent Hill 4, on the first visit, you've got a great handle on the rhythm of the game. Once you find a portal back to room 302, you get free healing, and enemies, despite being more numerous, feel easier to dodge around somehow in this area. The area, I think, just comes at a point when things should be getting more challenging, but they don't, and you start to get a bit complacent, and then maybe get a bit tired of it all. When the game takes healing away from you in the second half of the game, it improves the survival horror feel of the other areas. But this area needed more challenge, even on hard, I feel, which is indeed a shame. One of the only other good things about this area for me is the skinned mic tape, which sounds like it should be this really grotesque thing you can listen to in your radio. Turns out it's just named that way because, well, the aforementioned pervert is being stripped down to his underwear in the hallway, so skinned and berated. But it is hard to make out that's what's actually happening, so there's always a bit of uncertainty as to what the tape is actually about, at least on a first listen. But in the end, it's just an extra little bit of human flavour, which is really what this area is best at doing. But it was always the most difficult part of the game for me to enjoy. Seeing the mailboxes stuffed full of unread mail is a delightfully human moment. The corpses of enemies that Walter himself likely left, as all the enemies are representative of things that Walter hated or murdered, shows just whose worlds these are. But there's so little for me to hold on to here that I think I'll just move on. Aside from smaller moments, there's nothing big to talk about. So, after Eileen is beaten almost to death, she is transferred to... So I've sort of done this all in a slightly funny order, given that I spoke about both initial visits and revisits in each section. This is where the escort questing actually starts, and also where the game pulls a nice reversal on you. We've been discussing the power of the gaze a bit so far in this video, how it can be possessive. Hospital World's room with the giant Eileen shows how it can be turned back on us. A player in room 302 can opt to spy on Eileen, objectifying and possessing her time and time again, without her knowledge. When she is beaten after Apartment World, the Robbie the Rabbit bunny plush that has been sitting on her bed back to you now rotates and points at you, another turning of the gaze against you, of making you aware of the harm that looking can do. It can reduce, distort, and destroy. Eileen's enormous head, coupled with what some players have dubbed potentially erotic breathing, turns the power of the eyes back on you. The eyes follow you deliberately around the room. For a player who did indeed spy on Eileen, this moment chills, because you get at least a cursory understanding of how this gaze can function. There are a number of other great rooms in the hospital, mainly along this great corridor. There's a room where the floor is covered in some glue-like substance, which slows Henry down to a pathetic crawl. There are incubators over which an umbilical cord of uncanny length is strung. The one with the figure swathed in cloth hung from the head by the ceiling, dangling over a bed, that's maybe my favourite one. In fact, one of my favourite rooms in the entire series, I think. It's just so eerie, so pervasive in the mind. It's frightening because it's quiet. These rooms don't have to make sense, they don't even have to tell a cohesive story necessarily. But it's the gaps in our own knowledge of this place that make it frightening. Is the person hanging there someone who committed suicide? A murder victim? One of Walter's victims? We just don't know, and in fact we can't even really begin to guess. But our minds are very good at trying to guess, even unconsciously. There is a lot that our mind works on while we play a horror game, and these kinds of rooms are some of the best for prodding our imagination toward dark directions. I disliked Apartment World because exploring it was too samey. The rooms in Apartment World, while still individualized, offered little to properly spark the fantastical in the imagination, the way these rooms in Hospital World do. Hospital World's rooms come to break that monotony. The corridor is randomly generated too, meaning that each room comes in a different spot in every playthrough. We can see flayed skin on a wall. We see Walter operating on a woman with the same model as Claudia from Silent Hill 3, and we can worry as he steps threateningly towards Henry and watches us, glaring, gazing. Strangest of all, perhaps, is the bed with a bloody lump beneath the sheets and seven needles jammed into it. I wish I could say this was an allegory for the final boss, who requires spears to be jammed into him to be defeated, but he needs 8 spears, not 7. So the mystery seemingly persists. That's the magic of this unexplained horror, where we don't receive definitive answers. That's the magic of art. We will always be wondering at its strangeness. When something isn't resolved, it will always be tickling the back of my mind when I think about that story or that game. The lack of need to explain it shows to me that this is a development team who are confident in their ability to unsettle, to frighten. It also shows that the game is confident enough to stand on its own 2 feet, that it doesn't need to overindulge in lore documents or explanations of every sight that we see. It is a game, mostly, at least in its best moments, that is restrained. You know the magic, the kind of magic where you are left wanting more, not lamenting that the game is going on for too long. Hospital World is such a short, sweet location, but it does so much right, including the stairwell where you fight all the patients. Just fantastic. It is also worth noting that this is yet another hospital in a series full of them. It is the last Team Silent developed hospital, whatever you take that to mean, but it is not the last hospital in the series. We revisit Alcamilla Hospital from 1 in Origins, Homecoming, and Shattered Memories, and the series is finally free from the hospital level in 2013's Downpour. The idea of the hospital in horror is at first a looming kind of threat. We are inherently disempowered as patients or even guests in a hospital. Staff have at least some kind of power there, and we tend to go there as a patient or a guest because we're sick, or because we're visiting someone who is sick. A hospital is a place we go when our body, or in some cases our mind, experiences a failure. And obviously when that happens, that in itself is inherently frightening. Medical procedures are, at least to a layperson like me, esoteric, and can be a bit frightening. That's what body horror as a genre rests on, the idea that we are fragile, just shells of meat, which we pilot with our finite consciousness. As we see bodies disturbed or distorted, just as the gaze has been doing to us, we tend to see the world unravel just a bit further. We recognize our own mortality, our own frailty, and in doing so, we begin to let our guard down. We start to collapse, just a little, beneath all we are. That is the wondrous nature of good horror, that it can bring us to these revelations, even in a totally safe, controlled environment. It can just trick us into thinking that it is not controlled. Body horror can be more than this, of course, but within the context of the hospital, it draws us immediately to thoughts of our own mortality. Our own mortality is thrown into stark contrast in horror games. We die, but we do not really die. The moment we die in a game is a release, a relief. The pain is over, at least for now. The tension has burst, even as our character dies slowly and painfully on the screen. But body horror is also incredibly relevant to how we see the female bodies on screen in this game. As I've said, Walter is demonstrably misogynistic. He's not a nice guy to anyone, but he reserves his darkest, most brutal killings for female figures. The patients, while they make a funny sound, are pretty disgusting when you think about it. The belching sound comes from hitting their exposed organs. Their bodies have been visibly desecrated by extreme violence. Horror and humor, hand in hand, remember? Black comedy in a very dark way. Walter also venerates the room as his mother. The object of his desires is perhaps Oedipal in nature, were we to channel some more Freud. Hospital World opening with a cutscene of him with his hands in some random woman's guts speaks volumes. He is evil and repulsive. And in terms of body horror, Walter has transcended his body, but also cannot properly escape it. His defeat is spelled at the feet of his corpse. Alex Cuff, an artist, writes evocatively and very powerfully about the experience of embodiment. I am a writhing, fleshy mass of bone and tissue, desperately attempting to make sense of the information that surrounds it, thrashing aimlessly and meaninglessly to understand its context. Freakishly peering through 2 small holes wreathed in skin and listening through tiny bones in its ears. Is thought a horror? A feeling of disconnection? If I wish to function, I disregard this feeling. When I step out of my door each day, I have no other choice but to ignore the thought that I am an animated mass of meat, defying gravity with its calcified bones, controlled by a limp muscle in its head. I have no choice if I wish to continue any normal sense of activity. But it is there, it is a curse, and it horrifies me. Humanness horrifies me. Imagine all these people, these skin-wrapped containers, communicating to each other their thoughts, making things, defying nature, making some sort of order out of this meaninglessness. As Alex Cuff, a trans artist, writes, body horror is incredibly relevant to queerness, to transness. The limitations of the body are so relevant. How media frames the body shapes the text. There are no out-and-out queer characters in Silent Hill 4, The Room, but how the bodies of Walter's victims are treated culminates in the hospital, the apex of one part of the game, and the bottom of the other. Everything pivots around the cutscene where we pan over Eileen's broken body, when Henry finally reaches her to confirm she is alive and well. Then, we are tasked with bringing her with us, making sure she is okay. But she, like us, is vulnerable. At this halfway point, we can no longer heal freely. Our apartment becomes infested with hauntings, with specters. We end up broken and afraid ourselves, but not to the same visible degree that Eileen is. Eileen is possessed by kindness, forced to sacrifice herself for a man who not only brutalized her, but killed others and brutalized them. He freed himself from the limitations of his body and became a spirit, but even that spirit can be killed. He is both free and not free. The hospital crystallizes all of this for me. The women in this game so rarely get the opportunity to strike back, to get revenge. Eileen is the only one who even has a chance of surviving. The submachine gun you can give her if you do particularly well in the game in subsequent playthroughs is not really enough to make up for the abuse they suffer. Hospital World gives Eileen one chance, one solid, memorable chance to reorient herself. When she breathes, her enormous head shuddering in the corner of the room, she is able to reclaim herself, her body, with the power of the gaze, even just for a single moment. She is able to reorient the possessive look of the player, the abusive violence of Walter, the terrifying disjunction of worlds that is Silent Hill, and make something of it herself. But within the game's construct, she's also a product of Silent Hill there too. It's not actually her. Even within the game, it's just a representation of her. In the end, Eileen is never given a chance to really own herself. The game is a struggle against a villain, against possession, that she will always, at one point or another, succumb to. Her body is just another one for Walter to abuse. The hospital in Silent Hill 4 is short, sharp and sweet. It is the last time Henry is alone, and the first time he must escort Eileen, all at once. It is a collection of weird and wonderful rooms stitched together by a corridor inhabited only by sentient, aggressive wheelchairs. It is a special place and a special game, the midway point between all worlds, which leads to our first encounter with the midway point between all worlds. Huh. The horror concept of the back rooms, much like most internet horror, like popular creepypastas or the SCP Foundation being dogpiled on, is far too overexplained and overdone, in my humble opinion. I like to think that my videos expand upon the horror but don't reduce the magic, merely enhance it. I don't want to think I'm reducing horror's arsenal of tricks, because if the magic still works on me, then surely it should still work on anyone. People often think that logic is what is needed to explain everything, to make things terrifying. But horror often comes from the unknown, the unexplained, the abstract. We don't need logic, we don't need extended documentation, we don't need long wiki pages. We need the surreal. This is all to say that the in-between world segments of Silent Hill 4 are real oddities in the grand scheme of things. Like the backrooms I reference, they're liminal in-between spaces where seemingly nothing much happens, where you see weird, tortured creatures spasm in rooms, and the silhouettes of abuse, again, rear their ugly heads. You can go through a hole in the middle of the circular staircase that leads to nowhere, seemingly, but takes you back to your room. Yet another moment of surreality that works really, really well. Everything circles back to the room. The spiral staircase winds down and down, and every door at the bottom of the staircase takes us to the next world. It is the connective tissue of the other world, like the subway is for the city. Writing about David Lynch, Robert Arp and Patricia Bray write that our world is not inherently logical. We impose logic upon it to make sense out of the random and absurd happenings all around us, and to create a sense of order out of chaos. They continue regarding the specificity of logic, saying logic is the study of the principles of correct reasoning concerning the formation and evaluation of arguments. As we've seen already, they say, people don't always abide by these principles. The way characters and people reason has consequences for how they live their lives in the film and real worlds alike. Good and bad reasoning affect the beliefs people are willing to die for, the policies we adhere to, the laws we make, and the general way in which we live our lives. All the worlds we have seen are filtered through our antagonist's view, his life. His life is not a logical one. He is manipulated at every turn, and he is lonely, lost, and alone. He is a figure of sympathy, but also a nigh irredeemable monster. We understand him better than we do Henry, easily, by leaps and bounds, and we hate him for the worlds he has constructed around us that he has forced us to move through. The spaces can be frustrating in Silent Hill 4, because I think I expect them to be more sometimes. Sometimes it feels like the spaces are just there to shove more monsters in, but in transitory areas like these staircases, I think we get a real sense of just how lost Walter is or could be. If we take every other world to be a mental representation or a metaphor of how Walter feels about the world or a particular place in it, then, well, we're basically moving through Walter's gaze. We are understanding how he feels about the world. And if that's tortured and anguished and perverted, then yeah, that makes sense, given that he's killed a lot of people. The Gothic, as Laura Hubner writes in her book, Fairy Tale and Gothic Horror, is often propelled by a perpetual cycle of repression, triggering a return of the repressed, followed by repression's return. There is a constant state of reinvention and reappraisal. We try to hide things, we can't. They come back to haunt us. The ghosts of Walter's victims follow us, true, not through the connective tissue, but through walls they still pursue. They turn up again and again in each successive world. Walter's worlds are uncoverings. Uncoverings of his murder plot, of just how deep his various psychoses run, and just how far the game will go to torment us. There are callbacks here to other places, other people. A large moth is reminiscent of Alessa's moth collection in her room in 1 and 3, for instance. These spaces are draped in the series' famous fog. Connective tissue, the lifeblood of so many games, so many series. How games deal with downtime is integral, particularly in horror. When the atmosphere in these sections, and now at home in Room 302, is so stagnant, so repetitive, we are left to feel repulsed and depressed by the game. These are some of the best spaces in the game, and they last for so little time. We need these spaces, as short as they are. Without them, the journey to each new place wouldn't be so special. Without them, the game would not be the one that I love so much. Baudrillard's simulacra is something I gestured at in my section about Water Prison World. There's a sense of falsity to everything these days if you spend your time on the internet for too long, but even outside of that, it can be difficult. The post-truth era creates hyper-reality, where the sign and the referent are detached from one another. It is our inability to distinguish reality from a simulation of reality. Every time we play through Silent Hill 4, The Room, every time we cross back through into Room 302, we wake up in our bed. Was it all just a dream? Who can say? Our goal from the first time we take control of Henry is pretty clear. get out of the room. The chains need to be unlocked. So, fishing around in the pockets of the corpse we've been renting with, we find the keys. And then, as the keys do their job, we open the door, only to find out we're in the other world. Have we been in the other world this whole time? Have all our efforts been for nothing? Or did we just not move fast enough? Was there just not enough time to stop room 302 sliding fully into the other world? What is reality anyway? Baudrillard's idea is not untouchable. God, for instance, can be simulated, as Adam Turl argues in his article Being with the Ghosts. Turl writes, "What if God himself can be simulated?" Baudrillard asks. God can be and is intimated in countless faiths without becoming a facsimile. The shaman becomes God in the ritual, and then becomes themselves again, or was, for a while, both. Baudrillard's successive phases of the image are one way rather than dialectical, assuming realism as the starting point of representation, and a static reality being represented by an ever-abstracting mimetics. Turl goes on to say that instead of communication, there is a mise-en-scene of communication, a performance of communication, a simulacra of communication. When it comes to stepping outside of room 302, when comes time to fetch an umbilical cord from the superintendent's room, there's a simulacra in front of us. We were expecting a communication with reality, but we didn't get the reality we wanted. The world in front of us looks indecipherable from the world we worked hard to escape. When Eileen is drawn back to Walter, we feel dread. When we hear the almost comically abusive but still awful and tragic rants of Walter's father, who hates Walter literally from the moment he was born, we are connected to Walter's trauma. There are some really great camera angles here, some long shots that show Walter waiting at the end of a corridor, guns ready. The twin victims are replaced by grotesque enemies called Bottoms, who are basically twin victims, but less cool and more grotesque. There's a lot to love here, but not very much to say about it beyond the lack of reality, the lack of certainty, and the repetition of the cycle. Again. We have repeated every world, and now we repeat the apartment block again. We have seen our own room through disembodied eyes. We have been beaten, broken, and bloodied at every turn by the promise of freedom, only to have it snatched away from us at the last second. The things we once understood are now revealed to be the uncanny, the abject. The things we know so well that we cannot absorb them properly into ourselves. How can we? The horror at the heart of Silent Hill 4 is the loss of control of the gaze. If what we saw through the peephole in the windows was false, then what have I ever really possessed? If even my senses can fail me, if even that which I possess is a trick, then was there ever any escape? We are back in Water Prison World, back in Forest World, circling through the same story, descending the same stairs to each world again and again and again, seeing miserable grey fog, seeing all the victims we failed to save again come back and try to kill us. Did any of it really matter? Who am I seeing? We are haunted constantly by the game and how often it repeats itself. And this can make us miserable. We want to change things. We want to break free from the cycle. We want to end the trauma. Hauntology, as perceived by Mark Fisher, was always closer to revolution than anything else. The desire for things to be different, rather than a mere nostalgia, which is more like, oh, how I wish for things to return to the way they were. Why did things change? How did I end up here, we think. As we walk back through outside room 302 to confront Walter for a final time, yet another repetition, another backtracking, the song, Resting Comfortably, plays. It is womb-like. There is no other way I can describe it. The final repetition, the final dance. Like Philip K. Dick's science fiction novel Counterclock World, the story ends in a journey to the womb. Dick quotes, "Place there is none, we go backward and forward and there is no place. Outside room 302, there is no place. We go backwards and forwards, there is no place." What is reality anyway? In the context of Silent Hill 4 The Room, the point of reality is to make you believe in the dream, to take away your certainties, to make you question whether you will ever escape. When you are trapped in the ever-repeating forward and back, it can feel like there is no escape. Eileen feels pity for the man, for the child that almost murdered her. She is brought to his side and wanders back up through the complex, leaving Henry's side for the first time in hours. Walking alone on our journey back to the womb that is room 302, we are left to reflect on everything we have been through to reach this moment. Sciental 4 has demanded a lot from you, the player. It has shown grotesque sights and will show a few more. And while I said the only places that work consistently for me are room 302 and Water Prison World, this final level feels appropriately final. As though it could just be the start of something new, something horrible. The promise of Walter's other worlds has been liberation just around the corner. Oh, just 21 victims, Walter, just a few more. Then you can see your mother, then she can be reborn again. When you lay eyes on the spaces that adjoin God, what is reality anyway is a fine question to ask. But I suggest one addendum. What is reality to me anyway? It is how we relate to those spaces that matter the most. Subjectivity is the most important part of these narratives. How we as players relate to these spaces defines what we like about them and what we take away from them. We ourselves become the ghosts. I might dislike the apartment complex, but I still find myself drawn back to this game time and time again. It is one of my favorite games ever, despite its eccentricities. And it may sound as though I am making excuses for it, but I don't see it that way. I see it as acknowledging that without those flaws, I would not love it so much. Games for me are more engaging when characters must struggle to get somewhere, where everything achieved is not achieved without sacrifice. Walter is the main character of Silent Hill 4, but Henry and ourselves suffer immensely to reach the end. Frustration encompasses us, but it is through this narrative of frustration that I personally find meaning. I am the masochist who these games were made for. What is reality to me, anyway? These are the rooms that I am perhaps most obsessed with outside of Room 302, which makes sense because I think these rooms are embedded within Room 302, or at least within Walter's psychoses of what he thinks Room 302 to be. The smooth black portal that you can touch and travel through doesn't transport you immediately to the final boss chamber, which is interesting enough. No, instead it takes you almost to a boss room foyer, but one with no apparent purpose. The chamber just has another portal that takes you down to the next room. It also has these enormous spaces for human bodies lining the walls. This room is one that has always left me a bit transfixed. It's another liminal space, a liminal space that directly adjoins others. Everything about Silent Hill 4 resides, seemingly, in the uncanny. We see spaces throughout the game transformed into mockeries of the human body. On the outside they appear architectural, but on the inside we dip our hands into the wet gore and viscera of multitudes. We become closer and closer entwined with the grotesque sights that we see the longer we play. Again, possession, again, drawing ourselves ever closer to the horrors just by witnessing them. Nietzsche's famous saying, "When you gaze into the abyss also gazes back at you," is passed around a fair bit, I think, but it is hardly more relevant than the delectability of a game that we must focus on. We have to really focus on what's going on, especially on a first playthrough if we want to make it out alive and get to the end of the game. This makes us more open to receiving what the game is trying to tell us. So when we wander around this weird, haunting space before the final boss, waking up as though we ourselves are in the womb, it is not hard to see that the space has fully absorbed Henry and us. Henry is not just the receiver the twin victims whisper about. We are the receiver. This room is the point of no return for a reason. Perhaps this is reality. Perhaps this is where Henry has been the entire time, and it is only with this final challenge that he will obtain freedom. We wake up, now drenched in red, our gaze finally having been appropriated completely. Blood soaks our vision, the slots for bodies on the wall go seemingly unfilled, open, ready to accept sacrifice. Or perhaps, in the absence of such, we can understand that the sacrifice has already been claimed, dragged down to the final level. As we drop down to the next level, the bodies are receptacles for the spears that are used to wound the final boss. We draw the spears from the bodies and impale the monstrous representation of the crucified Walter. The influence of tortured Christian iconography seems obvious when one puts it like that. Walter, the long-haired messiah figure, deliverer of a new age, stabbed in the side 8 times with spears dubbed the Spears of the Holy Mother. In the worst ending, he triumphs and resurrects something. Not what he wanted at all, yet another of Dahlia's tricks. The worst ending destroys the world, and Walter doesn't even really get what he wants. The enormous machine, the Eileen machine, is, I believe, based on the gravity drive from Event Horizon, the 1997 film, according to the website Silent Hill Memories. More importantly, however, this final room in the game has the enormous monster known as the Conjurer up against the wall. He can only be harmed by the umbilical cord that the superintendent has been keeping in his room, and only once all the spears have been jammed into his body. Depending on how well you've protected Eileen, the camera will cut occasionally, or very frequently, to show Eileen taking another step towards her doom, possessed by Walter's spirit, ready to be valiantly self-sacrificing. The ideas about Eileen being possessed and sacrificial, the stuff I brought up at the end of the Hospital World section, are worth touching on again here. Douglas E. Cowan writes about female ritual sacrifice in film that we can call it occultism, call it black magic, call it arcane peasant mythology, call it whatever you want. Make no mistake, this is still the religious imagination at work, and this is that imagination's dirty little secret. The end of Walter's ritual is the final mutilation of a woman in an enormous, absurd grinder. The religious sacrificial elements inform us that this is a twisted ritual, but a ritual nonetheless. The slow or quick walk to the grinder is one that we are made to feel terrible about, but also one that we can recognize. Get what that is? That's right. It's a form of the abject. Something about our culture we recognize but don't want to. Something that we can understand but never condone. Yet it is a part of us, nonetheless. As the view flickers back to Eileen time and again, we are made to gaze at her self-destruction as enabled by Walter's evil scheme. We gaze at her, we witness her possession. And if we have not protected her, we are made to feel culpable in her quick march towards death. It was us, the abject, the uncanny, the thing we recognize in the mirror, who helped do this. Eileen was going out to party before she was killed. Cynthia flatly turned Walter down at some point in the past, encouraging his obsessive, brutal behavior. Cowan writes, "The control and hoarding of sexuality, whether through enforced peer bonding or the imagined restraints of one's gods, renders the sexual body, with all its cultural taboos, behavioral preconditions, and various accoutrements, as ritual capital, the more powerful by virtue of its scarcity and desirability. That which is available in abundance is rarely viewed as a resource, and is often squandered without a second thought. Sexuality as a resource explains, at least in part, both the sexualized aspects of human sacrifice, the aesthetic as exempli gratia of the sacrificial imaginary, and the central place of the woman within that imaginary. Simply speaking, Walter's misogynistic acts have a historical framework within horror and within society. These dark acts are a reflection of the abject part of religious imagination. We look on in fear or horror, but we cannot tear ourselves away. This area has always filled me with trepidation, and even a weird melancholy. It is the last room made by Team Silent. It is the quintessential large, semicircular boss room with a large monster. But it's a struggle between you and the human murderer at the end. Even if that human murderer does have superpowers, and even if you also have a rusty axe. It is the best way, I think, to end a saga about abuse and the consequences of trauma. The impact might manifest as monsters, but it is always felt by human beings. Finally, Walter collapses to the floor and stares up at the ceiling, reaching for the light. "Mum," he says, finally content, and dies. The Conjurer is a half-born creation, a representation of all Walter's most primal, monstrous desires. When it is killed, Walter himself can be felled, and at the ending of it all, we can be left to reflect on what it is we just went through. I think what has impressed me most about Silent Hill 4 in the years I have spent playing and replaying it is just how powerful its core ideas remain and how appealing they are. The horror of the gaze is an almost universal one. The gaze can possess, objectify, and corrode. We can be unsettled by the intimacy of the gaze. When Walter appears at the peephole, that's a shocking moment. Or it was for me. When we realize that Walter has been watching us through the wall of our bedroom in a way, that's another shocking moment. Everything in Silent Hill 4, regardless of whether you think the gameplay works or not, is seemingly connected by the thematic gaze, the motif of looking and possessing. Walter's terrible murders enable him to essentially hijack people's lives, transforming them into ghosts who pursue and damage you just by being in your vicinity. This can be a frustrating gameplay mechanic, particularly when you don't know where to go, but it also makes the ghosts harrowing and powerful. And the power of the gaze is revolutionary. When the gaze is not enough, we desire even more. We desire ways to create new avenues of the gaze, to perpetuate possession in new ways. As Barbara Bayat argues in her book Petrifying Gazes, Danae and the Uncanny, apparent anomalies or transitions along the artistic timeline arise when a controlling gaze is no longer considered sufficient, and the artistic psyche rages out of control in search of new outlets. This process, which actually entails a stylistic revolution, ensures that new artistic autonomous zones must be explored and exploited, a new genius loci of style. Team Silent's strength, their enduring legacy, at least to me, is how many developers have strived to emulate their possessive horror. The way in which they used cameras and perspectives helped to codify and redefine what it meant to look in horror games. Many horror games since have done fantastic work building on, or splitting away from, the work done by the original four Silent Hill games. The mood that they managed to attain is certainly a genius loci of style, a melding of melancholy, misery, and miasmatic gore wreathed in mist that people still chase today in various ways. There is strength in being safely disempowered in a video game, knowing that you are at a disadvantage but cannot actually be hurt. Unlike the destructive, harmful potential of objectifying heterosexual and or male gazes towards women, queer people or other minorities, exploring the power of the gaze within a fictional horror setting can be frightening, but it can also be enlightening. We can understand ourselves and others better through the vulnerability afforded by horror games. They allow us to be vulnerable in ways other games never achieve, both from a gameplay perspective and an emotional one. The shock of seeing Cynthia, horribly mutilated and bloody, dying in your arms, is merely the first note that shows what a horrible, manipulative killer you are dealing with. And while he is horrible and demonstrably misogynistic, seemingly unable to recognize the basic humanity of woman, he reduces the figure of the mother to an inanimate space, after all. He is also a figure we are capable of feeling some amount of sympathy for. His rotten life gives him an unacceptable, classically Freudian excuse to look, possess, and strike, and the menace behind his polygonal model pointing at Eileen's room is weirdly striking even after many successive playthroughs. Silent Hill 4, The Room, stands the test of time because it allows a player to feel vulnerable within the walls of their own home. There are other games that expand upon this idea of space and the gaze that I will get into later this year. But for now, I think it is safe to say that this particular iteration of Silent Hill, for all its obvious, easily observed faults, has an intelligence and a level of malice that can still dominate the imagination today. It remains one of my favorite games of all time, and likely will defy time for some time to come. A fantastic experience, and one that possesses me every time I play it. To look is to possess. I mean, what the hell? My channel's growth over the last year or so has really been beyond my expectations. I think I went from just shy of 1,000 subscribers at the end of 2022 to more than 2,000 subscribers at the end of 2023. It's humbling, it really is. The incredible amount of graft, the hours and hours of script writing, the countless hours spent editing videos together, and all the things I've learned have been so rewarding. But there's always more to learn. There's always more mountains to climb. So just a profuse thank you to everyone who has encouraged me on this journey to get better and to strive for more, to get better. And my deepest thanks, of course, to my patrons, Frank Alloons, Future Cityscape, Blue Voices, and Damien for your support. It has sustained me through the year, and you've helped me out so much with motivation, just pushing myself to get better at what I do. As well, my deepest thanks to my family and my partner, whom I appreciate putting up with the hours I spend talking into a microphone and hunched over some editing software. The point of these videos, really, I want to show that even something as silly as a hugely long video essay on ancient mouldering horror games cannot just be interesting or merely entertaining, but educational, philosophical, and at least gesture towards the academic. And if you're out there worrying or fretting about making a video or something, or not believing you can do it, I can tell you, if I can do it, you can do it too. Everything that I do is so amateur. I mean, I record some of my scripts sitting on the floor right now. I edit things together between work shifts. I write even just for 5 minutes part of a script before I go to sleep. These games that I talk about trigger self-reflection. That's what I'm interested in. And then I guess I just wanted to say, chase what you're interested in. Pursue your passions. Because not only does the internet need more sincerity, I think the world needs it too. The world needs more people looking out for each other. Stay safe, everyone. See you again soon. Sorry for the wait. Hope you enjoyed.